So a US drone strike overnight wiped out Iran's top general as he arrived at Baghdad airport in Iraq. The Pentagon has confirmed Major General Qassim Soleimani was killed at the direction of President Donald Trump, along with the deputy commander of the Iranian-backed militias known as the Popular Mobilization Forces, Abu Mahdi al-Muhandis. The Iranians are already vowing to create some kind of hellish revenge, crushing revenge on the United States of America. Obviously, they've attacked Saudi Arabia in the past. They've attacked tankers in the Gulf, in the Straits of Hormuz in the past. They've also been responsible for firing rockets into parts of Israel. They've occupied southern Lebanon. You know, it is a very much a tinderbox situation. Let's talk to Dr. Paul Stott, columnist and Henry Jackson Society executive director as well. We'll find out what is likely to happen next. Dr. Paul, a very good morning to you. Welcome.
Good morning, Mike. You only ever seem to want to speak to me when there's death and destruction afoot.
Well, I mean, I wouldn't say that. There just happens to be quite a bit of death and destruction on the go in the Middle East at the moment. And it seems to me that depending on who you talk to, this is something that was long needed to be done and will not cause any greater retaliation from the Iranians than we're going to do anyway. And a dangerous man has been removed from society.
Well, this is certainly one of the most important events in terms of global security and counterterrorism since 9/11. I certainly put it as being that important. Soleimani really was the sort of heart and soul of Iran's pivot since the Islamic Revolution. You know, somebody who'd been a hero in the Iran-Iraq War in the 1980s, right, who'd led Iran's attempt to develop a sort of Shia crescent of like-minded regimes. So it's work in Syria, propping up the Assad regime. It's work with Hezbollah in Lebanon, which you mentioned. You know, he was at the heart of all of that. So he's been an incredibly important player, and one who, having survived in that position for a very long time, seems to have disastrously misread America's intentions and, you know, put himself in a position where he could be taken out, and he was.
Yeah, I mean, I said this morning that it's almost like an episode of Homeland in the way that America can now have these incredibly surgical strikes, literally from a base somewhere in the bottom of the Pentagon, where they're all sitting in a situation room, directing the traffic, if you like. I mean, it's a very interesting modern development in warfare, isn't it?
It is, and it makes Soleimani's tradecraft all the more bizarre, really, because I don't know if you followed on Twitter over the New Year holiday, but Donald Trump was, if you like, protesting very strongly about these demonstrations outside the US embassy.
Yes.
And Iran's spiritual leader intervened and actually tweeted Trump directly in English, saying, "You can't do anything." Well, as we found out, the Americans can.
Well, exactly, yeah. I mean, they also sent 750 troops, I think, didn't they? I don't know where they are specifically. I don't know if they're actually in Baghdad. But what, realistically, can Iran do? Because they appear lately to have become the sort of... I mean, they're very powerful, they've got plenty of weaponry, but it's almost nuisance value that they seem to be providing at the moment.
Well, time will tell on that. Iran certainly has people who it feels owe the Iranian regime and owed Soleimani. So certainly President Assad in Syria and Hezbollah in Lebanon. It's long been felt that if, for example, there was a major attack on Iran or an invasion by the US, that the tactics of Hezbollah would be to launch a fusillade the likes of which Israel hadn't seen before. Upon that nation. We will now see if that happens. Part, of course, of the dramatic effect of killing Soleimani in this way, though, is that those who feel that they can act with impunity, either against America or potentially against Israel, ought now to be having second thoughts, because they're clearly not secure from the type of action which we've seen overnight.
No, because I guess if you're an Iranian member of the militia there, you're going to be very worried about the information that the US clearly was able to get, to the tune of waiting for this guy to come out of a plane and into a vehicle in an airport, a sort of an airport access road in Baghdad. So they knew precisely where he was, precisely at the time they wanted to kill him.
Well, it's even being reported that there were three sets of vehicles on that journey, that two were basically acting as decoys, and then the third and final convoy was the one that Suleimani, also Naim Qassam, one of the main guys in Hezbollah for many years, as well as the militia group that you mentioned within Iraq, that they were in this third convoy, and the Americans knew not to hit convoy one or convoy two,
right,
but to hit convoy three.
Wow.
So the intelligence here appears first class.
It does indeed. And as far as what they're likely to want to do, I mean, we saw the action in the Gulf where they were sort of taking tankers hostage. We saw the attack on the oil refinery in Saudi Arabia. Have they got any ability outside of the Middle East, if you like, to retaliate, in the sense where, you know, they you know, Al Qaeda in the past might have blown up a US embassy in Nairobi, or they might have tried to attack mainstream America actually on their own home soil?
Well, it's worth stressing here that because Iran follows the minority trend within Islam, the Shia belief system, that a minority of the world's Muslims, if you like, look to Iran. And indeed, many of the radicalized jihadist groups have been on the opposite side of the fight,
yeah,
in Syria. And if you go on social media this morning, you'll find some of those activists really quite happy to see the back of Suleimani. Mm. This is somebody who'd deployed his fighters, had helped set military strategy against Islamic State, against Al-Qaeda. So I don't think we're going to see attacks from those supporters, from supporters of those groups in the West. I do think there's a case for the intelligence agencies across the West to be on the ball as much as possible, because we simply don't know publicly, you know, who the Iranians have deployed as sleepers potentially, or who there may be supporters of Hezbollah, supporters of Assad, who may well feel the need to, if you like, pick up the gun on behalf of Iran in this instance. So there are threats, but we mustn't overstretch them. Really, the arena of battle is the Middle East.
Right.
And I think there's a danger in saying, as I've seen some people saying this morning, that, you know, Trump risks provoking a regional war, risks provoking conflict in the Middle East. We've already got conflict in the Middle East. We've already got war in the Middle East. We've had it for many years for a whole series of reasons. What's happened here is one of the central players has been taken off the battlefield.
Yes, and I think that anybody sensible would think that has to be a good thing. I mean, the fact that Bernie Sanders and Joe Biden are being very critical of Donald Trump will come as no surprise to the White House and come as no surprise to the Pentagon. And in fact, he hasn't really done anything more than what Bill Clinton and Barack Obama did for years, which was to try and hunt down Osama bin Laden without much success.
Well, sometimes red lines are red lines,
yeah,
Mike. And if you remember, Obama set red lines in Syria and didn't stick to them.
Mm.
And I think with hindsight, that was, whatever people feel about intervention in the Middle East, that was a mistake. In international law, a country's embassy is its sovereign territory. What we've seen in Iraq over the past few days is one country, Iran, encouraging its assets to attack the US embassy.
Yes.
And that was a red line. Trump has declared that red line, and he's acted to uphold it.
Exactly.
And I think that's the right thing to
do. I think you're absolutely right, and I can't imagine that they would have been in any way disappointed or surprised that he retaliated in the way that he did. And you're quite right to say maybe this will be a wake-up call for them. But we've got, according to Lucy Fisher from The Times, about 400 troops in a camp north of Baghdad. We haven't really heard much on foreign policy from the new Boris Johnson government. I imagine they'll be saying something about this at some point today. Would you be advising the British troops to be removed from there or to keep them there?
Well, we don't know what commitments privately Britain's entered into with the Iraqi government. I think whatever commitments there are do need to be reviewed, because certainly the initial statements from Baghdad are very worrying, that they seem to be, if you like, siding with the Iranians over this action. And that does mean that any British presence or commitments there, I'm afraid, probably now need to be reviewed.
Sure. OK, Dr. Paul Stott, as ever, hopefully next time you have a conversation with me, it won't be when, you know, there's been some massive conflagration in the Middle East, but from the Henry Jackson Society's foreign policy think tank. He's a Middle East analyst, of course, and I'm afraid whenever there is something bad that happens in the Middle East, he is our go-to guy, Dr. Paul Stott. He's very knowledgeable, and he knows precisely what is going on. And as he says, this was clearly the right thing to do. Anybody who thinks that Donald Trump has been in any way reckless here by killing, cutting off the head, basically, of one of the top ghastly militia leaders in the Middle East, who was basically vowing to do more harm to American interests, who was vowing to kill more Americans, and who was actively encouraging more attacks on US embassies, I think Donald Trump did the right thing. I think he was entirely within his rights to do that, and I'm quite happy that he's done it. We will, of course, keep you abreast of any developments. The Iranians, of course, are vowing revenge, but they would do that, wouldn't they? Whether they